Good evening. Are we okay to go? Okay, my name is Mary Ann Hamilton, and I'm chair of the Shelburne Democratic Committee. We're pleased to welcome you tonight to this event, which is co-sponsored also by the Charlotte Democratic Committee and the South Burlington Democratic Committee. Let me introduce Chris Shaw, chair of the South Burlington Democratic Committee. Unfortunately, Ed Cafferty, who is chair of the Charlotte Democratic Committee and also acting chair of the Chittenden County Democratic Committee at this point, is ill and will not be able to be here. He sends his regards. I am so pleased to welcome you all here to hear T.J. Donovan, the Attorney General of Vermont, and we very much appreciate having him. It gives us great pleasure and an honor to have him here tonight. And before I introduce him, I just want to see if we have any people in the audience we'd like to introduce. There's Kate Webb, one of our legislators from Shelburne. Jessica Brumstead, also a legislator from Shelburne. I don't know if we have others here, but I think that's pretty much it. And we've got David Scher, who's Assistant Attorney General, and we're pleased to have him as well. All right, great. Well, thank you so much for coming, all of you. Now, TJ will speak for about 20 minutes to a half hour, or as long as you want. and then we'll open it up for questions. So in order to use our time effectively, we are passing out index cards. So if you would write your question on an index card, and we'll collate them and try to avoid duplication and save time and be more efficient that way. So please, if you don't have... If you don't have a card, please get one. All right. Thomas J. Donovan was elected this last November to his first term as Vermont's Attorney General. After serving as Chittenden County State's Attorney since 2006, he's the 26th Attorney General of Vermont, and we're pleased to have him with us. He was born and raised in Burlington. He's a native Vermonter, and received his law degree from Suffolk Law School in 2000, and then worked as an assistant DA in Philadelphia before returning to Vermont. And on returning to Vermont, he was the deputy Chittenden County State's Attorney for some time, and then practiced law, specializing in civil litigation and criminal defense work. In 2010, he started the Rapid Intervention Community Court, which was an award-winning criminal justice program available to nonviolent defenders whose crimes had been driven by addiction or mental illness. Throughout his career, TJ has championed the rights of the most vulnerable, bringing compassion and common sense to our legal system. Tonight, we hope to hear from TJ on a number of topics, including Vermont's role in opposing President Trump's travel ban, what we can do to promote public safety through access to justice, what Vermont is doing to address campaign finance law, in the age of Citizens United, and much more. Did I cover it well? We'll see. All right. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming Attorney General.
Well, thank you. This is a great turnout for a Thursday evening. I understand we're competing with a play downstairs, but as Joan Lennis said, there may be some acting up here as well. So I'll do my best to perform. Marianne, thanks for that kind introduction, and thank you all for coming out. I really appreciate it. This really is a great turnout, and I think it underscores the point of what's going on in this state and what's going on in this country. This is a unique time, and I say that I think all of you would agree. Okay, That's not working. Okay. That's fine. I'll speak up. It's working for the TV. Okay. That's fine. I'll speak up. Can you hear me, Rick? Good. No? I'll use the mic. Can you? Can you hear me now? Okay, all right. This is a unique time. Now we got it. And our democracy really is only as good as the people who are willing to serve it. And that's everybody. Coming out tonight, listening, being engaged, speaking up, speaking out. And when we talk about what's happening in our state, and we're talking about what's happening at the national level, for me, I always try to find the positive. And the positive for me is this. This has been one big civic lesson for our country about our government, about our institutions, about our Constitution, about the separation of powers, about federalism. That's a good thing. That is a good thing. And, you know, so I got sworn in on January 5th. And we had a remarkable 15 days. It was unbelievable. It was the best 15 days ever. We got so much done. And then January 20th came. And I'll tell you a story. We were another good thing has been, you being in the opposition party as a Democrat, it's been a unifying experience. And coming in as a new attorney general, there's an organization called the Democratic Attorney General's Association. And I think there's about 23 Democratic attorney generals. And surprisingly enough, there's like 56 attorney generals. And I thought I knew civics, but I guess we include the territories and whatnot. But there's about a core, 16, 17 attorney generals. And so there was a conference, and we all got together. And it was the day that President Trump first issued his first executive order, which was now known as the travel ban executive order. And we're in Florida. And I'm the new guy, so I'm not really saying much. I'm just taking things in and listening and introducing myself and talking about the executive order. And I walk out by the pool, and I see this fellow who spoke very eloquently earlier in the day by the name of Bob Ferguson from Washington. And he's in a swimsuit he's got like a Hawaiian shirt on and it's unbuttoned. And he's working two phones. And I kind of shy, I said, what's he working on? Well, sure enough, that Monday, he was the first, Washington was the first state to file an injunction against President Trump's executive order, which of course was the court found to be unconstitutional, which is still being litigated, which we joined in, which we're proud to join in. But that experience of getting together with the colleagues from different states and really understanding the unifying power of protecting people's civil rights, of protecting our environment, of standing up to what we believe to be federal overreach, to protecting our Constitution, for standing up for women, all in a space of 100 days. And when you think about what I would call really the dismantling of some of the protections that have been in place, not just the last 8 years, much, much longer than that. It really has been, it really is amazing how quickly many of those protections have been dismantled. And the importance of attorney generals to not just be the first line of defense, but in many cases, frankly, the last line of defense in the protection of individual rights, really human rights, environmental rights. And from a personal and a professional experience, it really has been invigorating. It's been invigorating to be in this job. Dave Shear, who works with me, is here, and Natalie Silver. And there hasn't been a day where we're saying, okay, what do we do? You know, something new has just come down. Something's just happened, or this is going to happen. What do we do? And I can tell you, on that day of January 20th to today, not only in the state of Vermont, but really, I think, across this country, every lawyer is relearning constitutional law 101. Because here was the thing. Nobody practiced constitutional law. But we're all relearning constitutional law, and it's a great thing. It's a great thing. It's a great thing to try to understand immigration policy, to understand immigration law and the interplay from the federal government to the state, to understand about the 10th Amendment, an amendment Democrats don't talk about, frankly, very much, but we should, that really gives a lot of power and authority to the states on issues that should be left to the states. It's been great to debate about the Fourth Amendment when we talk about this issue of whether or not local law enforcement, Shelburne PD, South Burlington, state police, should act as de facto federal law enforcement in enforcing federal immigration laws and what that means in terms of liability, not only to the state, but also what it means in terms of, is this what our values are in terms of community policing? Because when you talk about policing, when you talk about law enforcement, for me, it's about trust. It's about trust and really viewing law enforcement, and the police have a tough job and they do a good job, but viewing the police as guardians, guardians of the people, but also for folks, for regular folks, to see the police as guardians. And what underlies that is trust, is the willingness and the ability to go to law enforcement when you're in trouble, when you need help. That's what the police do. And to think for a moment that some of these policies are having the exact opposite effect, because what it has done is push the most vulnerable, who are already on the margins, let's be honest about it, more into the shadows. And when you talk about not having the confidence, not having the trust to call the police, to call 911, to go to the ER, to go to the doctor when you're sick for fear that you're going to get in trouble, that doesn't enhance public safety. That hurts public safety. That doesn't enhance public health. It puts us all at risk. So these are the fights that have come. Obviously, we have been successful, and I really credit Attorney General Ferguson is a tremendous leader on these issues. Maura Healey out of Massachusetts is, in my opinion, just a complete hero and a true rising star. In terms of she's the Attorney General of Massachusetts, and I've been very strategic in my alliance. Whatever Massachusetts, New York, and California do in Washington, usually Vermont's right behind. But the power to band together across states, across this country, to stand up for folks has been something that I know I'm proud of, and it's something that I truly believe is in the tradition and the history of our state. When you think about Vermont, we think about equality, we think about tolerance, we think about protection, we think about privacy. It's about respect. And all these fights that we're having, for me, it's very consistent with who we are as a state and who we hope we remain as a state. One of the challenging aspects of this has been keeping pace. again, that pace of change has been so quick. And I'm a big believer in our institutions. And I'm a big believer of separation of powers. And we can talk about the executive branch, we can talk about the legislative branch, and really we're talking about politics. And that's fine. We can have that debate. But it really is the independent judiciary that sets this country apart and what, in my opinion, makes this country the great country it is, the independence of the judiciary, having the final say, that power of judicial review. And the concern about the rhetoric that would demean or belittle the judiciary in this country is incredibly troubling. It's incredibly troubling to me. And so we have to do, when we talk about that civics lesson, we have to do our part, that we can respect the debate, we can respect the political discourse, but we have to respect the courts. We got to respect the sanctity of the courts and the judges and their decisions. And we can use the courts as they're designed to question, to appeal, but when that final judgment comes, we have to abide by it. And that's going to be the test of this democracy, is the judiciary, in my opinion, as we go forward. It's going to be the judiciary. And that's not to say we don't disagree and we don't look to seek redress through the courts. But the language is so harmful to our democracy. And what we have to do, and this is why I mean this, when a crowd like this comes out on a Thursday night, we can't get to the point where we get worn down, where we get tired, where hate and discrimination is normalized. That's a real concern. That is a real concern, that we get tired of standing up and protesting, that we get tired of fighting for people because that pace of change has happened so quickly, that we do have to double down, that everybody has a role to play in terms of standing up for democracy and standing up for human rights, because that's really what it is. You know, oh, Paul, I gotta talk about South Burlington. The idea that we're living in a world today where people are given license to hate now, and it's normalized. And they say, well, I won't be held accountable to politically correct standards. It's not about political correctness. But when you have people who are engaged in a political debate, which is fine, but when you terrorize kids, I'm sorry. People have lost their way. We can engage in a political debate. We can have a debate about history. We can have a debate about what's appropriate in terms of a name and what words mean in terms of symbols and history and the legacy of those symbols. Have a debate about what we spend on education. But the minute this crosses over into violence and threats of violence, this is no longer political debate. This is now criminal activity. This is criminal activity that's going on in South Burlington. Let's be clear about it. And the person or the persons responsible for it should be prosecuted and should go to jail for a long time for engaging in terror. It's nothing less than terror what's going on in that community. It's outrageous. It's outrageous. And my concern is this is more. I haven't spoken about this issue, and I'm looking at Chris and Paul because I know you guys are from South Burlington. But if you draw that line about the rhetoric that we engage in our political discourse. We've lost our sense of decency. We've lost our sense of decorum. We've lost our sense of what is fair play in politics. And you're seeing it descend at a local level into something that is incredibly disappointing and disturbing to me. We should have debates on all issues. And there's no, there, and I know this, and I know many people in this room know this, that oftentimes some of the most hotly contested issues and debates are at the local level because it's real for people. It's tangible. But I think we have an obligation as citizens, as elected officials, not to descend into the rhetoric that has taken over the national political discourse. It's incredibly important for all of us, whether we're Democrats, whether we're Republicans, progressives, independents, whomever we are, that we get a model of behavior and that we got to be willing to stand up for people who are being attacked. You got a kid who spoke out about a symbol that he found offensive. I commend him. That's a courageous act. 17, 18 years old, getting attacked in this community for speaking out. That's what we want in our citizens. We don't want to silence people through fear and threats. And I hope that we all can do our part in encouraging that civil discourse in this community, because that has crossed the line where you have the idea, and this is that normalization of hate, of discrimination, that school lockdowns are going to be normalized. This is not acceptable. We shouldn't accept this as normal. You know, and I get young kids in that school district. And this is when we talk about our democracy, we are talking about our public schools. Doesn't matter, again, who you are, what label you have. Perfectly fine to have a debate about how much we spend or what we spend it on. But schools should be a place that's safe. Schools should be a place where kids find acceptance, where they're encouraged to speak out, when they're encouraged to debate about controversial issues and to debate about our history, our shared history, and what it means to them that's relevant today. And the idea that we would threaten somebody for speaking out, I think we all have to take a look in the mirror and make sure that we're doing our part so this community remains inclusive and it remains safe for people to continue to speak out regardless of who they are or what they feel, and that everybody matters. I do want to talk just briefly, and I want to take people's questions because I know there's a lot of questions. You know, when I was state's attorney, one of my passions is criminal justice reform, and it remains so. And I don't think we can talk about criminal justice reform without talking about the opiate epidemic in this state. And what we need to do in terms of reforming our criminal justice system is really taking a public health approach to the issues of drugs, to the issues of addiction. And the fact that when we say to folks in this state that if you're sick, we're going to treat you, that should apply across the board to everybody. And we shouldn't have a separate system for folks who are heroin addicts. And the idea that we have waiting lists for people to get into treatment in this state is a shame. It's a shame. Because when you talk about the issue of addiction, when you talk about the issues of mental illness, we know this, they don't discriminate, they touch every single one of us. But the issue of poverty does discriminate. And you come from a family of resources, you're probably more likely than not that you have health insurance, that you have a doctor, that you can get into treatment. For the poor, that diagnosis comes at the bar of the court from a prosecutor and from a judge. And the prescription's a jail cell or probation. It's a failed approach. And we gotta change it in this state. We spend more money on corrections, locking people up in this state, than we do on higher education. Over $150 million into our correction system. And when you talk about retaining young people in this state and not losing young people, when we talk about economic development, when we talk about jobs, yes, that means affordable higher education. Yes, that means making sure that kids can go to school in Vermont and are not overburdened with their debt load and can choose to stay here to go to work and to start businesses. And when we talk about public safety and a vibrant community and an inclusive community, absolutely, it's an affordable higher education. It's also about affordable housing. So we truly have an integrated community and diversity in our community as well. Economic diversity is incredibly important. So it's jobs, it's higher education, but mostly it's healthcare. It's access to healthcare. You know, when you talk to people, folks who come through the criminal justice system, you know, as Marianne said in her remarks, I grew up in Burlington. And I went to public schools in Burlington. And one of the highlights for me of being state's attorney, that frankly I miss being attorney general, you're in court every day. You're talking with real people. And a lot of the folks that you'd see in the courtroom were folks I grew up with, and are good people. And perhaps you couldn't articulate it when you were young, but with the power of life experiences and hindsight, you could understand, in hindsight, some of the struggles a lot of these folks faced. But now you're seeing their kids, and it's generational. We can ask ourselves, what are we doing wrong? What are we doing wrong when it is the second and third generation coming into the criminal justice system, when it's the second and third generation living in poverty? And for me, when we talk about healthcare, as I said, access to healthcare, we should have universal prenatal care across this state. We should have, and I commend Kate and Jessica and Joan Lennis for doing this, for expanding universal early childhood education for all kids. That is what's going to make the difference as we go forward in this state, to making sure that we make the investments early on in our community, that we build those investments, that we invest in our people, that we have them as they go through. We also have to talk about, when we talk about that access to healthcare, not only in the back end in terms of drug and treatment, but prenatal, early childhood education, we also have to talk about, and yes, when we talk about epidemics, we should be talking about the mental health crisis we have in this state. And we have to understand that mental health crisis, that we have to push that stigma away, and we should have robust and accessible mental health services in our public schools and in our schools throughout this state, not just for kids, but for families. For families. And we have to do a better job of understanding the impact trauma has on people and the lifelong impacts trauma has on people. Because at the end of the day, when we talk about where's the money going in this state and services and these great debates we have, we just got to go back to where people came from. And we got to actually have the power and the courage to understand that we're going to have to spend some money to make investments early on in making sure that people have a fresh start to get ahead in life. Not just spending on the back end to a safety net, but making sure on the front side that we give people truly building blocks to get ahead. Because we got it this reversed. spending over $150 million in a Department of Corrections, saying this is our safety net for the poor, is our jail system. That's what it is. I know there's a few lawyers here. Challenge anybody. Challenge anybody. Walk into the courts. Walk into the jails. And tell me the demographic you see. Because it will be the poor, it will be the uneducated, it will be the underemployed or the unemployed, people with addiction, people with mental health issues, looking for health care interventions in the criminal courts in this state. This is where we have to change the thinking and the investments to be putting it on the front end, to those building blocks, to achieve on the back end that affordability in terms of a house and housing, affordability in terms of higher education, and finally, the decent, good-paying job for every Vermonter, which is the truest and best form of public safety. That's where I want to get to. We got to fight the fights on the national front in order to preserve our way of life here and throughout this country, but we can't neglect the work we have to do at the community local level to make sure that when we go forward, that next generation has the tools they need to be successful in an ever-changing and difficult world. And we see that. I know I went off on a tangent a little bit on the South Burlington, but we see it. We see people. We've normalized hate, and we've given people the license to hate under the guise of not subscribing to political correctness. And we have an obligation to stand up and to rebut that argument. Not to shout down people, not to trample on people's free speech, not to trample on political discourse, but to stand up for decency and respect for everybody. Happy to take your questions.
And we have a number of questions. We'll start with a simple one. How does the AG office decide what issues to take up?
Great question. I would say that some of the issues find you and some of the issues you find. I mean, for me, you know, I kind of alluded to this earlier. When I started, I kept telling people I want to be hyper-focused on Vermont. I want to deal with the local issues of this state. And I certainly knew who won on November the 8th. But I wanted to focus on Vermont. Obviously, that changed. It really did change on January 20th. And I would say the priorities shifted to responding to the federal government, at least initially. And I think it was the right decision to make. And that was not to neglect any of the earlier priorities, but to shift focus and resources to addressing some of the federal issues. So not to go way too into the weeds, part of the AG's job is to defend the state in terms of when the state of Vermont is sued. You're going to defend the state in terms of representing the state. But the initiatives we're trying to push out are a couple. Number one, this idea of community justice that Dave Shear, who's here, is heading up. I'm big into consumer protection and making sure that people have enough information, enough tools in order to make informed decisions about what they should or so they don't get scammed. I'm also a believer in the backbone of this state is small businesses. And for me, the best way to, and the job of the Attorney General is essentially to enforce the law. But for me, the best way to enforce the law is to give people the opportunity to comply with it. And when we talk about small businesses in this state, which is by far most of the businesses in the state, we have to acknowledge that they don't have compliance officers. They don't have general counsels. It's mostly mom and pop shops, two or three people doing the best they can. And what I think what we can do, and we have done this, we've gone over to 40 businesses, talked with them about what are the issues affecting you most in terms of complying with the rules and regs of our state. You know, one of the things that came back was we don't understand the law, like literally the way it's written. pretty amazing. And so one of the initiatives we're taking is to essentially, I don't want to say interpret, but write law in layperson terms so people understand what the obligations are and make it user-friendly for people, and to really kind of take that litany of laws that most businesses are struggling with and to make it more user-friendly to build this compliance. That's also consumer protection, you know, because when you talk to folks, when they don't feel that they can call the Attorney General's office or somebody in government, they're not going to make that call. And they may not intentionally not do everything they're supposed to be doing, maybe cut a corner here, cut a corner there, and consumers, Vermonters lose. And so it's about hitting the reset button, making sure we're talking to the small business community, making sure we're understanding what their needs are, and then responding to them in terms of not only rewriting the law in easily understandable language, but also tapping into what the concerns are in the community and then going back into whatever the subject matter expertise is of state government and solving people's problems. I mean, this is not rocket science to me. It's actually service. We should be helping Vermonters be successful. We need to grow our economy. We want more jobs in this state. That's a good thing. And what we should be doing is allowing the job creators to focus on growing their business and let state government help them by building this culture of compliance. You got a question? Let us help you answer it. One guy said to me, really classic Vermont business down in Rutland County, and I would love this job if I could ever get it. He restored old barns. Yeah. I mean, this was his job, was to restore old barns. And he had six employees. And I was talking to him, and he was lamenting his growth of six employees because the increase in paperwork and the struggles he was having of filling out workers' comp forms. And I'm saying, this is what we should be doing. Workers' comp, of course we want people protected. And we want people to pay into the system and play by the rules. But if somebody is struggling with it, we should help you. We should help you and make it easy for folks to truly understand what they need to do in order to comply so he can go forth, hire more employees, and restore more barns. I'm for it.
Okay, I have five cards here with similar questions. I think this is the question of the day.
Okay.
These are the questions of the day. What can this brave little state do to frustrate the excesses of ice? I think all of the other questions in my hand fall under that category.
This brave little state. Here's my trivia question. Here's my trivia question. Who coined that phrase?
Calvin Coolidge.
That's right. It's great. So the question is about ICE, which is immigration and customs and enforcement, immigration. And great debates in this state and in this country about sanctuary cities, sanctuary states. And obviously stemming from President Trump's executive order. That we've joined, obviously, has been stayed, has not taken effect. And let me talk a little bit about that in terms of Vermont's role. So I know Bob Manchester's here, and he can jump in on this as well. Essentially, for the state of Vermont, as I said, represents the state. Not individuals. We represent the state as an entity, state agencies, state institutions, state colleges. And in terms of filing suit, we have to show that we have what's called standing. Essentially, have we been harmed? Has the state been harmed? State institution. And in terms of that, the initial executive order regarding the travel ban, Washington State's standing argument was one of economic harm, that this travel ban would economically harm the state of Washington in two ways. Number one, they're public universities, because the number of students from the affected countries and the number of professors from the affected countries. Number two, the economic harm was to their high-tech industry, because anybody who's familiar with Washington State, they have all the big companies, Amazon, Microsoft, Boeing, and they said the number of workers, foreign workers, high-skilled foreign workers from these affected companies who work in the state of Washington would have an impact in terms of hurting businesses, hurting state revenue. This is our economic harm argument. Obviously, from the state of Vermont, we don't have that argument. We didn't really have the argument on the public university issue as well, certainly not to the extent the state of Washington had. And so that held the day in terms of staying that executive order. But it also triggered the next executive order, which was essentially the sanctuary city executive order, which essentially said this: local law enforcement, if you don't enforce and comply with federal law, federal immigration law, we're going to label you a sanctuary city, and we're going to take away all your federal funding. And so you start saying, okay, well, what's a sanctuary city? Well, the short answer is there's no legal definition of what a sanctuary city is. It doesn't really exist. There's no definition of a sanctuary state in terms of a strict legal standard. And then in Vermont, a couple years, and really this goes again, I think, to who we are as a state and believing in tolerance and believing in respect and believing in local control. I mean, that is a value in this state, that we passed what's called a fair and impartial police policy that was effective last June. 2 years ago. And in that policy in the state of Vermont, it was really confusing to a certain degree, because you had, well, we have essential elements of our policy, and then we have what's called these non-essential elements of our policy, and the 75 or so municipal police departments, you can elect what part of the policy you adopt. Do you adopt the essential elements? Do you adopt the non-essential elements? Or, and if you don't make a choice, police departments, the legislature said, June 1 of this year, you are presumed to have adopted it all. So we had all these different policies, and in the policy, in the non-mandatory, non-essential language, there is some language that I think conflicts with federal law. And the bright line rule of federal law when it comes to immigration enforcement, which is exclusively a federal issue. Let's be very clear about that. Immigration enforcement is exclusively a federal issue. And the bright line law, the federal law, essentially says, hey, states and local law enforcement, you can't prohibit disclosure to the federal government in terms of immigration. So you can't have a state policy that says don't talk to the feds, essentially. And there was another part of that executive order that said, and you should essentially engage in, become the de facto immigration enforcement officers of your state. Well, we thought that was wrong, and I was proud to partner with Governor Scott in passing legislation that did a couple things. Number one, said very clearly, we're not going to have a registry in this state for anybody, mostly in terms of religious registries in this state, for fear of what may come down in terms of collecting information, whether it be religion, whether it be national origin, whether it be sexual orientation, whether it be gender. We're not going to have a registry. The second part of that law was, we're not going to allow local Vermont law enforcement to enter into federal agreements to do federal enforcement of immigration law. Can't do it in this state. But you still have that outstanding federal law that the fair and impartial policy of so many departments of this state are in, it's in conflict with it. And we got to fix it. We got to fix it. So essentially, the issue is going to be, do you run the risk of losing federal dollars by being in conflict with the federal law? I don't think there is no legal definition of a sanctuary city. I don't think we should call ourselves a sanctuary state. I think we have to remain compliant with federal law. I think we can work local policies at a local level and do what we do best, which is community policing, which is that issue of trust, which is the issue of trust not only from law enforcement to the citizen, but from citizen to law enforcement. And also, I want to say this, and I've done, you know, we rely on federal law enforcement a lot. State's attorney, on some certain cases, you call your federal partners. I did. And I think what's happened in terms of that executive order, and you make those calls on issues of public safety. But what these executive orders have done, they've essentially widened the net. That in the past, it would be true public safety issues. Murderers, frankly, where you would make the call. Sex offenders, where you'd make the call. But now, based on this executive order, what's happened is anybody with a criminal offense is now subject to deportation. So we have to work as best we can with our federal partners. And I want to say this, and I said this earlier today. I think we have to be careful in terms of demonizing federal law enforcement officers. They're taking their orders. And we need to be cognizant of the fact that we're condemning them for the exercise of their discretion. But at the same time, on many issues, we are asking them to respect our exercise of discretion at the state and local level. So this is an incredibly tricky balance, I would say, to achieve. But for me, we have to be compliant with federal law. And that bright line of not prohibiting disclosure, at the same time, perhaps building policies. Essentially, the policy comes down to what we have in this state is essentially don't ask in terms of status, but we can't have a don't tell. You can't prohibit disclosure in terms of immigration.
I don't know if you want questions, but I've been at two lawyer meetings last week, where lawyers have been articulating, this is like the recreation of the fugitive slave laws. We in Vermont doing our own thing with our own workers and our employees are now having to kowtow to a new policy from Washington. We seem to be powerless to stop it. And the head of this came to that person who was going to court, who was basically picked up by ICE and taken away with that. I wonder if you are in a position to raise the due process Fifth Amendment question, say, if an employer has good workers here who are complying with the law as in compliance with Vermont law, that we can stop them and have a show cause for why they have the power to take this man away in the middle of the day or the middle of the night to Boston and then deport him before anybody really knows about it.
Well, look, I mean, you raise good points, Bob, but the issue of that enforcement of the federal violation is exclusively federal jurisdiction. And when we talk about in Vermont, when we're talking about immigration law in Vermont, we're talking about migrant workers in this state. And I think we also have to have a conversation in this state about we love our agricultural history and we love our land. But I'm not sure we're acknowledging who's doing the work on the land. And we have to understand that when we talk about these policies, when we talk about public safety, like you want to talk about domestic violence, you want to talk about sexual violence in terms of immigration law, you will have a chilling effect on the reporting of those crimes because of what's happened to your reference of the courthouse. When you talk about the issue of not calling 911 or not going to the ER as a result of some of the immigration enforcement, that's what's happening to many in the migrant community. And so there is no easy answer. I think what we've done in terms of trying to challenge the executive orders in court to get those stays issued at the same time working incredibly hard in terms of getting this policy right is going to be a major issue in this state going forward, because we can talk about immigration enforcement all we want from a federal level. How this will play out in this state will be on a back road at 3 o'clock in the morning with local law enforcement. That's why these policies at the local level are so incredibly important. And what we ask our local law enforcement to do, and what we do to make sure that we're doing the training on what the policies are in this state while remaining compliant with federal law, I think is the right course of action. And this issue is not going away. I think we all know this. But I think we need to understand, or as I said, be cognizant of some of the rhetoric that we're saying. I mean, because when we talk about this, I mean, we talk about immigration, we talk about border security. We got a lot of federal workers in this state. We got a lot of federal law enforcement workers in this state. We have to understand that the question before us is how do we navigate this issue, not only through, because what the issue really, and I'm gonna go into the weeds here, but I feel strongly about this. Go in the weeds. What this comes down to is essentially what's called these administrative warrants. And how that shows up in what's called the NCIC database, roadside stop, 3 o'clock in the morning. What shows up? And what we're asking our local law enforcement officer to do, and understanding officer safety in all this as well. And that if we have a warrant that's been signed off by a judge and probable cause has been found, I don't have a problem with that. That's the rule of law. That's what happens. We do that all the time. The administrative warrant, there's no finding of probable cause by a neutral magistrate in terms of that Fourth Amendment analysis. In the debate of what that sanctuary city and the threat of the loss of federal funding essentially was this: if you don't enforce these warrants, we're gonna pull funding. And I don't know if you guys followed this, but for a couple of weeks, DHS, Department of Homeland Security, was putting out a list of municipalities and departments that were, you know, on the naughty list for not enforcing these administrative warrants. And Montpelier was on it. Montpelier's policy essentially said, we'll hold you, but we got to make sure that the Constitution's being followed and that probable cause has been found by a neutral magistrate in order to detain somebody. And many in the law enforcement community said, wait a minute, why are you putting us on this list, or why are you asking us to do this, when in many jurisdictions, towns have been sued for the unlawful detention of an individual based on that administrative warrant for lack of probable cause? That you held somebody unreasonably for lack of probable cause. And that's that issue of that administrative warrant. So one of the things that we did prior to town meeting day is we put out this guide, essentially saying, this is the law, these are the issues, these are some model policies. And talked to a few towns who found it very helpful. Talked to a couple other people, said, this is really confusing. And it is. And so in Massachusetts, and for me, that is the core issue in this debate, is that administrative warrant? And is it signed off by a judge? If you're going to hold somebody, and look, you get arrested in Vermont, and you get what's called lodged, thrown in jail, you get arrested on a Friday night, you're going to go see the judge on Monday morning. But what happens, at least in Chittenden County, and should happen everywhere, is we follow what's called constitutional rule, called the 48-hour rule, meaning you can't be held for more than 48 hours without a neutral magistrate, i.e. a judge, finding probable cause. And so every weekend in this county, at least, what happens is the local prosecutor gets on the phone with the police, reads the police affidavits, gets on the phone to a judge, and gives a recitation of the outline of the affidavit of probable cause. And so you have that finding of probable cause, so you don't have the unlawful detention of somebody. And that administrative warrant, you don't have the finding, as far as I can tell, the finding of probable cause by a neutral magistrate. There's an argument, well, there is probable cause. For me, the Fourth Amendment analysis is very clear. You need the neutral magistrate. Again, back to the separation of powers, back to checks and balances. And when we talk about immigration, and you talk about immigration judges, and, you know, again, learning stuff as we go through this, you know, immigration judges are executive branch employees, meaning they're not part of the separate independent judiciary, which raises questions for me. They're not what we call Article III judges. So navigating this in a way that protects Vermont cities and towns from liability, navigating it in a way that promotes public safety, respects human rights and civil rights at a real local level in terms of what our local police policy is, while remaining compliant with federal law, it's been a balancing act. And I think we're gonna get there, but you got a lot of competing factions on this, rightfully so, because it's such an emotional issue. But this is something that we've worked incredibly hard on. We're gonna continue to work hard on. I think, and not everybody agrees with this, I think in terms of having policies, I'm not sure we want 74 different police policies in this state. I'm actually erring on the side that let's have one policy that makes sense for everybody as best we can, and make sure that this thing gets adopted, make sure that we get people trained on it, and make sure that we're diligent in the continuing training and making sure that we're in constant contact with local PDs, that we're in constant contact with the advocacy groups who are an incredibly important part of this discussion. You know, I got to say this. I love the ACLU. They have done a tremendous job in this state and in this country. And there's a young lawyer for the ACLU, and Jessica and Kate, I don't know if you probably know him, Jay Diaz. Somebody that I highly recommend that this group invite to speak. Incredibly smart, incredibly articulate, knows this issue so well, and has been a great friend and really an educator to us about a lot of these issues. Because this is, as I said, it's not just the law enforcement side. This is a civil rights side. This is a civil rights issue too, and striking that balance is going to be key, and I can't say we're there yet.
Yeah, I'll do more.
One more?
I'm having fun. I'll do more than one.
More than one, okay.
More than one.
Okay, can we get the questions that have been written and brought to the front first?
I can't get my questions to you. They're all the way across.
Oh, okay. Hand it to me.
But while I'm doing this, what can you do about assault weapons and large magazines, 10-plus rounds?
You know, as Attorney General, not much, to be perfectly honest with you. That question is for the governor, it's for the legislature. I know that I supported background checks. I do support background checks. They're consistent with public safety. As I said earlier today, we have a crisis of mental health in this state. And there's a bill, and I don't know if Kate or Jessica can have an update on this, but there's a bill that I support that I think has gotten through some committees. I don't know if it's passed the full House, but it's essentially allowing the police to seize guns on domestic violence calls. This just makes sense because most homicides in this state stem from domestic violence. This just is, it's common sense. The numbers and the stats support this. This is not a infringement or the unlawful seizure of anybody's property. This is about protecting people, protecting women in this state, and it's something I support. It's passed the House, yeah.
Okay. I'll just ask the question here. What can you do to help Vermont begin the conversation about how to best repair systemic problems within our federal political system?
The short answer is this, right? The short answer is staying engaged, being civil, being respectful, and advocating for people. I think we can all agree what's going on in Washington is it makes your head spin. And I say that we are incredibly lucky for such a small state. We got Bernie Sanders and Patrick Leahy down there fighting for us and Peter Welch. So I think we keep doing what we're doing.
We'll take another question.
I have any questions.
Yeah, okay. This person said she was given a prescription after surgery for 40 OxyContin, and she only needed 3, and is questioning why this is still happening in 2017. And you might want to segue into the opiate crisis.
There are many questions about that.
Yeah. As I said, I think... the opiate crisis is the number one issue affecting the state. Certainly during my time as state's attorney and now as attorney general. And I think when you talk to most people who are addicted to heroin, they started on prescription drugs. Whether they got it for a legitimate medical purpose or where they got it to started to abuse it. It doesn't really matter to me how they started. The fact is that most people started on prescription drugs. And when you look back historically at this, and Bob, I know you know this, in, I want to say March of 2012, and I don't know why I remember this, but I was asked, what's the most important issue facing Vermont? And I said, prescription drugs, March of 2012. And we all know by January of 2014, Governor Shumlin gave his now famous State of the State address dedicated solely to the heroin epidemic. So from March of 2012 to January of 2014, how quickly that transitioned from a prescription drug epidemic to heroin for a couple of different reasons. Number one, you had this tamper-resistant, Bob and I have talked a lot about this, this tamper-resistant technology making it harder to snort. You had heroin coming in that was cheaper. You had heroin that was more potent, and you had it flooding this state, but you had the demand here to begin with based on prescription drugs. So it really was this perfect storm. And we can talk about enforcement. That's fine. Enforcement has certainly a role to play in this fight, but we're not going to arrest our way out of it. I can tell you that as a prosecutor. And I can tell you this, I'm not sure I found too many people who have suffered from heroin addiction who have been cured of heroin addiction from a jail cell. And here's the thing about jail, too. You're going to get out, and you're going to come back to this community. So enforcement's a part of it. Certainly you sell drugs for greed or for profit, and you should go to jail. That's my feeling. Intervention's a part of it. Naloxone's a good drug. People say, well, you're saving people's lives. Of course we are. Of course we are. You know, the Howard Center runs this safe recovery organization that's on the top of Church Street. And I don't know the current numbers now, but it was a needle exchange program. And then they started giving out naloxone. And over the course, I want to say, of 2 years, they had over like 800 reversals in this community. 800 reversals. And when you think about that, for a moment, and the issue, again, that stigma, and the issue, this ties into poverty, in my opinion, too, plays a role here. I don't think you can name another disease where we don't have treatment on demand. You're sick, you go to the hospital. You're going to die. You're going to get admitted, and we're going to get you some help. But we got waiting lists in this state, and we've lost this sense of urgency to treat this. And I commend Governor Shelburne for speaking the truth about this, that addiction is a disease. Now the challenge is, now we got to treat it like a disease. I feel really strongly, and this is not all that popular, but I feel strongly about this, that yes, the medical community has a role to play. Certainly the overprescription of drugs has been an issue. I do think they're better. They're doing better on this because of the education. But also, we need more doctors who are willing to prescribe maintenance medication for people. When you don't have enough docs, and when we talk about why we have waiting lists in this state, the rollout of the whole program was called this hub and spokes program. And essentially, these methadone clinics were going to be the hub. You're sick, you come into the hub, you get assessed. Do you need methadone daily? Do we need to come in? If you've been here for a while, we're going to push you out to a spoke. Well, a spoke is a primary care doc. And primary care doc will get you on Suboxone or whatever it is based on your level of need. And that's how it's going to work in this community in terms of this integrated medical home, if you will, from this hub. We never had enough spokes, which created the backlog in the hub, which creates the waiting list. Now, I give a lot of credit to UVM Medical Center. They have really picked up the pace of getting more docs willing to prescribe medically assisted treatment. We need more. This is not going away. And finally, in terms of intervention, in terms of treatment, it's also about prevention. It's also about prevention. You know, as I said, my wife and I get two little kids. We've had the question, when do we start talking to them about this stuff? Are we modeling the right behavior over this? You know, I was down in a community in the southern part of the state, and incredibly angry about the criminal justice system. They said, one lady said, you know, you stick a needle in your arm, that's your choice. And you say, okay, you're right. But I've also talked to enough people who struggle with this addiction, and I've asked them that question because in my mind, I can't fathom putting a needle in my arm. And I say to them, you know, why? How do you do that? And they talk about the desperation and how sick they are. It's not a rational choice. I'm not sure it's even a choice. And so a little bit more of understanding, I think a little bit more compassion and less judgment, and some more money in the community is going to go a long way. Yeah.
Yeah. Drugs often, and I'm very good at saying no, which gets very angry at me. But I just went to a medical conference to the docs just this week, actually, and there's a huge Vermont Department of Health kind of ruling that's coming down starting July.
Capping up.
Where basically, if this is a patient that's going to have acute pain and they're what we call opiate naive, or they're not used to taking opiate medication, we're supposed to be limiting the drugs to just about 10 pills. But it's also going to be patient education. The patient's going to need to sign a contract for this, as well as discuss other ways to help control pain. And it's going to be very important, I think, for the medical community that the population is part of this as well, because I think a lot of the providers are worried about patients getting angry at us to say, well, you're not really helping us anymore. And I think it's great, because when you look at the statistics, as this question said, a lot of the patients, I think a quarter of them don't even fill their narcotics prescription if they've had a surgery. And out of the people that fill it, 43%, I think, do not finish their medication. So these are all meds that are hanging out in the medicine cabinet, getting stolen, and the rest
Thank
of it,
you.
Which are kind of feeding into the whole problem.
Thank you.
If
TJ wants to make a comment on
I would just say, thank you, and prescription drug take-back day is April 29th.
There are lots of questions.
I'm happy to take questions. I'm having fun.
Well, who's the boss?
Yeah, I'm happy to take questions. It's all right. This is great. This is what democracy is about.
Oh, well. Well, then.
Five minutes max. Now, I do still have questions.
I'm happy to stay. Gentleman asking.
We've got a million people, people who want questions. I've asked most of these with the card, so we'll just throw it out. I'll just call people.
I saw is Bruce Locklear Rumble. It said that the doctors that were there to help those that were trying to recover were limited to 100 patients or 100 contacts,
yeah.
Something of that nature.
Well,
is that still true?
What you're talking about is there's caps on, in terms of when I say MAT, medically assisted treatment, is essentially the Suboxone providers. And based on the type of license you have, yes, you're limited to the number of patients, which last I checked was 30, 100, or you could be kind of a super prescriber, and I think go above that. And look, to your point, and let's acknowledge that doctors have practices. We're not saying, hey, take on 100 new patients today. But I think if we can have a coalition of the willing, and I give credit to UVMMC on this for doing just that and building the numbers in terms of the docs who are willing to prescribe, if they're taking four or five, I'm okay with that, as long as it's 20, 30, 40 docs who are now engaged in this practice. And I think that's what's happening. And look, that's a credit to the leadership there, because this, for a long time, up until a couple years ago, this was exclusively a criminal justice issue, and it just did not work. And so there are those limits, and I think we have to be reasonable, because I'm not always reasonable in my request, because the need is so great, of understanding. And look, I will admit this. I certainly was educated on some of the challenges of the business model of doctors, of saying, hey, listen, you're an MD, you can write scripts, take these patients. And they raised a lot of legitimate issues about some of the concerns and some of the challenges of doing that. So I think if we continue to build a roster of docs who are willing to prescribe, which we have been doing, I'm okay based on how many they can take that fits their practice.
Yeah,
Yeah, can you speak up?
I think we all know, or most people know, that most of the cows milked in the state of Vermont are milked by people who are here illegally. You know, using that word
yep.
for purpose. Is there a way that the state of Vermont could push the federal government for a visa program?
I think Senator Leahy and Senator Sanders have. You know, I'm going to get the name of the visa wrong. You know, we have an agricultural visa for folks to come and to pick fruit and apples. That's seasonal, right? And I know Senator Leahy has tried to pass that. In fact, I think it passed the Senate, but failed in the House. And look, yes, we the economic harm. I'm up for any good idea, and that sounds like something we should talk about.
Of your description of the desperation that addicted people feel. I have a problem creating new blood sugar, so mine tends to fall. Well, I have made, you know, resolutions not to have candy or to eat something or to lose a few pounds.
Carol, we need a question, because we only have a few more minutes. What's your question?
Oh, it was going to be a contribution in support of his description of the desperation that people feel, and I wanted to make it more like something that everybody experiences.
Okay, so you're saying there's a universal feeling.
So I'm saying that if
people
want to lose weight, or if you just right. can't bring your blood sugar up without reaching for that candy, sometimes you tell yourself and make a resolution that you're going to not eat something. And just as you've made that resolution, you pick something up and put it in your mouth. And it's not reasonable.
Yeah. Well, we're not reasonable.
I wanted to make it concrete, exactly the kind
Thank
of
you.
Override that our brain does sometimes.
It does.
Thank
One
you.
More question, TJ?
Sure.
TJ,
can I have
a question? Tell me, why don't we use Maple Leaf Farm as one of them? Places for beds for yeah. those that suffer from.
Well, Maple Leaf Farm is closed.
Yes, but can't we resurrect it?
We should. Look, we need more treatment capacity in this state, and I am for whatever gets that done. You know, there's been a lot of talk that we're going to have a new methadone clinic run by a private equity company up in Franklin County. And there's a lot of debate. You know, shouldn't this be run by the designated agency, you know, private company? For me, I'm so desperate for more beds, I don't really care who does it as long as it's open, it's accessible, and it works. Now, the problem is, that's not opening either right now up in Franklin County. And the theory behind Franklin County was this would essentially reduce the waiting list in Chittenden County because you get a lot of Franklin County folks coming down here to receive treatment. So, yes, we need to get our act together in terms of having a strategy of creating more treatment beds in this state. Hey, look, I've driven folks to Valley Vista. And you drive across the state because that's the only place you can get them in. And again, it goes back to that issue of this is the only disease where we don't treat people, and we need to start being honest about that and holding ourselves accountable and actually saying, hey, and I know we got legislatures in them. For me, we can have rhetoric all day long. You want to talk about values? Start looking at the budget. That's the statement of values of where we're spending money in this state, and I'm not sure the money's there, and I'm not sure. There are other legislative proposals that dealt with increasing accessibility to medically assisted treatment didn't get off the wall of certain committees. You know, this is about values, and that budget is the biggest statement about our values in this state.
I think we need to stop.
He just called on Maria.
I'll call.
You did? Oh,
we got 5 minutes. This went to 8:30. That was a truth in advertising. I'm for consumer protection. Truth in advertising.
There's a couple of issues I'm really concerned about. One, obviously, is the budget. I really think because of the impact of the federal government, we're going to be impacted profoundly. But on a more personal note, I think with the opiate addiction, I think what we're not talking about is not only the group of people who are affected personally by being addicts, but the children that they have and their families. And I often wonder why, and I don't know if you have any claim to do this, but legislators in the room, why we don't put funds, if we can, into the jail system, because we have a captive audience, use that as a facility to rehabilitate mental health, have mental health workers up there, have family group things, you know, teach these people who are in jail how to be a family. I mean, you've got a captive audience.
Yeah.
And they're not going to be let out. And the other thing that I would say is I think prisons aren't safe because there's drugs in there too.
Yeah.
But I think what I would like to see is that everybody involved in the criminal justice system takes some kind of coursework to understand what works and doesn't work. There's some very hardline people who think this is the way to go, you got to do a 12-step program, whatever. I just think, I like your concept of opening it up. I don't know what the answer is. All I know is we need more money. And anything we can do locally, please let us know. I would be one of your markers.
Yeah, thank you.
Can I add to that briefly?
Yeah.
I think lobbying is really, really basic, and it can be good or bad, but speak up, please.
I think we haven't really talked about lobbying and lobbyists and how we let drugs in the first place.
Yeah. Let me cite one fact that's troubling. When you talk about kids, we have an incredibly overburdened family court system, and the number of kids that have gone into custody as a result of what's called TPRs, terminating parental rights, staggering rise. Terminating, mostly women, their parental rights, and I'll tell you what it is. And I asked this question to a guardian in family court the other day. And I said, are most of your cases neglect cases as a result of heroin? I said, absolutely. And absolutely, we have to put the safety of the child first and the best interest of the child. I believe that. But on the other hand, I also believe if we call addiction a disease, that we have to believe in remission and people can redeem themselves and continue to be productive, loving parents. But we're not going to be able to get there without treatment in the community. And if we're being really honest about this, the role, again, the stigma and status poverty plays in terms of this addiction and disease, because there are plenty of people who grew up in alcoholic homes in this state whose parents were never brought in to family court and never were asked whether or not their kids were safe or at risk. That's not to minimize this issue of child safety. It is to be brutally honest, again, about who is represented in the court system in this state, and it is increasingly the poor, and it's increasingly women who are addicted to drugs. And you raised the issue of jail. Anybody who has worked in the criminal justice system has to adopt that definition of insanity, doing the same thing over and over again but expecting a different result, because that's what that system has become. And the numbers prove it. Look at the recidivism rates. Look at the money. But you start talking to these folks, and as I said, I grew up here, so I knew a lot of these folks. And you start, and I'm not an expert in this stuff, but you start understanding about the role trauma plays, about seeing domestic violence in your house, the role addiction plays, the role poverty plays. And we had this training from a gentleman, and he was talking about the issue of stress and dysfunction on kids and these adverse childhood experiences, the ACE study, really remarkable stuff, that the trauma these kids face early on impacts on life expectancy, health, higher rates of mental illness, higher rates of addiction. And he was talking about this, and I said, well, wait a minute. I grew up in a family of six, Irish Catholic. We know what dysfunction is. I'm a believer in dysfunction. It makes you stronger. Builds character, resiliency. And he said, no. He said, the stress that I'm talking about you don't know if you're going to be eating tonight. You don't know if dad or mom's boyfriend's going to beat mom tonight. You don't know if mom's going to be passed out high on the couch. You don't know if you're going to be safe in your own room. It's toxic. The stress is toxic to these children, and it plays out throughout a lifetime of despair and really destruction to them. And when you go into these jails, you go into the jails and you actually sit and talk to people, particularly women, you will hear stories of sexual violence. You will hear stories of domestic violence. You will hear stories of emotional abuse. But mostly what you will hear is that nobody ever protected them, that nobody validated their concern, that they didn't have access to the justice system, access to somebody that they could confide in and talk to and trust. And this is not rocket science. When you hear that and people internalize this, man, I do some of the things, the self-destruction behavior too. Drinking, drugs. And it's not an excuse. It's not to say personal responsibility doesn't matter, but what it does is to acknowledge some of the barriers we all face, some more than others, and some of the second and third chances that we receive. And I think one of the challenges, and I'm talking to a group of Democrats here, one of the challenges we have, I think, as a party, is to always say the people that we are supposed to advocate for and stand up for, would they feel comfortable walking through that door tonight and sitting in this room with us? That's the challenge. It really is about acceptance. It really is about tolerance. It's allowing people in and understanding and acknowledging the difficulties, the barriers, and the challenges that people face, oftentimes as innocent children. And because you see it play out. That's, you know, going back to that access to healthcare, but I'm also a believer in just acceptance. You know, most people are good people. And I'm not a believer that we define people by their worst acts or by some poor judgments. I believe that people can redeem themselves. And when we talk about the criminal justice system and mental health, this should be done in the community. It should be community health. We shouldn't send anybody to jail to get better, because they don't get better. Thanks for coming out, guys. Thank you.